very much for that welcome and those lovely words, Stefan. And I particularly turn to Claire to thank her for the enthusiasm that she has shown about organising this event. And I really do want to, I hope that you can get this regional food research collaboration node off the ground, because as a visitor since 2009 to City University Food Policy Centre, I've been so amazed about how they do actually go beyond the academy to work, actually not only in civil society, but to, they're the first people that a lot of politicians ring up and say, come in, we'd like to talk to you. It's a really exciting centre to be with, and yes, the food research collaboration is a very important part of that. So, what is my perspective? Well, I want to say from the outset, it's a developed country, global north, first world perspective, but I am going to touch on some of the implications of food system, food decisions, the everyday decisions we make in the UK or back in Australia for the producer regions in all over the world. So actually, in Stefan's introduction, he really touched on this, what I would call a developed country government perspective of what we call the food crisis. And he mentioned one of them, one of the big debates, and that is that what we see are multiple forms of malnutrition, disturbingly, often coexisting in the same household. So you'll see people with micronutrient deficiencies, like vitamin B deficiencies. They are normally weighted people, but they are malnourished in some way. You'll see people who would be classed as overweight and obese, and you'd see the very underweight. And I have just put there, almost echoing Stefan, we really do not know what to do about that. It was much easier when we said food poverty and undernutrition, or being too thin, went hand in hand. But now we see within the same households, in the same communities, a whole mix of forms of malnutrition. We do not know what to do about it. I think that is one reason, the second dot point, that we actually keep on talking about overweight and obesity, certainly in public health. And we, for very good reasons, we say it's a risk factor for a range of conditions up there, type 2 diabetes, cancers, bad knees, bad hips. And the reason governments are so concerned, they say, are costly treatments. Now we're reading in the UK press about ethical decisions re-surgery, should surgeons operate on obese patients. We know very moving accounts of those people who have felt body shamed by the press and by academics. And productivity commissioners the world over, and certainly the OECD, regularly issue reports about lost productivity due to absenteeism and presenteeism, going to work sick. So what are the plethora of public policy responses to this overweight and obesity? Behaviour change programs based on nutrition education. The answer is, if people just knew what to eat, then they would eat properly. We're trying to improve consumer access to affordable fresh food, particularly through charitable approaches, food banks and social supermarkets. Governments are encouraging industry product reformulation, so to cut back on some of the ingredients they're putting in food. There have been agricultural research and development programs more private than public of late, and that's to try and improve the nutrient qualities in wheat and other staple crops. There's also been acceptance that if we can't prevent overweight and obesity, then government should pay for bariatric surgery because that's the most effective treatment. That's highly debated. And of late, much more recently, there is a bigger and growing debate about minimum income support, household income security, affordable housing. So what is the food provisioning context of how of householders as they're trying to eat a nutritious diet? So without a doubt, the responses have been multi-pronged. They've been disparate. A lot of these do not connect with one another. They have been largely nutrition-based, not those last two, but the four above are all based on nutrition science. But they have been ineffective to date. And I guess this is something that where I am coming from is why. So these are the public policy responses. What have other actors been doing? Well, very much food companies have been seeing in the rising prevalence of diet-related disorders, to which they are major contributors, they have been seeing an opportunity. Okay, we can develop disease reduction products and services. And I'm going to come back to this thinking in a few minutes. So I put in that first dot point that there's a contradictory force for profit-making food enterprises. You can put the fat, salt, sugars in the food in order to make them tastier and cheaper by doing so. But now you are being blamed by government for your share of the responsibility of malnutrition. And so, well, what can you do about that? You can not take, you can reformulate, but you can also add to your portfolio of products by bringing on disease fighting products and services. And then what is the role of citizens and civil society and individuals? Well, there's a term in social science called ontological insecurity or ontological security. This is where you feel that everything, this is a very crude way of explaining it, but you feel everything's all right with the world. There is a congruence between your beliefs, your actions, and the actions of people around you. But in the world of food, I think it would be fair to say there is a very big dose of ontological insecurity. And so what we're seeing is in green, for civil society groups and individuals pursuing foods that make sense to them, to their values. They want foods to do good to the environment, to their health, to one another. They want producers to get fair livelihoods. But then there is another response to this insecurity by citizens about their food systems. And that is to pursue individualized, but still ethical forms of eating. So people are taking responsibility for their bodily health, but it's in a highly individualized way. And really, the remainder of this talk tries to tease out that dilemma we have. Do we act just as individuals try to improve our bodily health by going to farmers markets, organics, etc., buying the latest healthy foods, or do we join wider social movements? And it is not either or. In this next few slides, what I'd like to do is to try and explain why I think we've got to this point where, in fact, there can be this ontological insecurity, and why, in fact, corporations are acting in the way that they are doing at the moment around nutrition. So here I'm drawing on my own work and the work of a small body of scholars, critical nutrition scholars, and they're broadly multidisciplinary, but they take very seriously nutrition and nutrition science. So some years ago, this comment was made, 2001, and it's obsessed me ever since. Using people's fears about their health and possible future disease risk as a basis for national development and company development is fundamentally different from how traditional foodstuffs have been marketed and sold. So Eastman and Mellenton were saying, look, there's something new here. We're playing on people's fears of their health in order to construct the entire food system. So I looked at some of this, and indeed I thought, yes, they're right. Over a very long period of time, a social process has been underway. It's been multi-pronged. We're all playing our part in it. There is no one lead actor here. I call it a cultural economy process for attaching nutritional properties and health qualities to food. It's both got an economic dimension, you're value adding to the foods, but you're only able to extract value from those foods if we're willing to pay a premium for that value adding. And there, that is where culture enters into it. And so, in fact, there's nothing innocent about us thinking about good and bad foods, healthy and unhealthy foods. These are cultural constructs. These are cultural understandings. They change with time. They differ between different subpopulations. But what I became aware of is that this has been quite an insidious or invisible social process lying behind most developed country food systems. It's based on three sub-processes. You've got to be able to count, enumerate, and I'm going to explain this in a minute further. You've got to be able to say this is better for you than that on the basis of some number, because that cuts through. You've got to be able to have research and development and food technologies that enable you to enrich foods, to add things to foods. And very important part of this process is you've got to be able to market and promote foods as being more special than other foods. This enumeration has been really important in terms of determining what we would call nutrient values profiles. This is what the Food and Agriculture Organization does. It's got nutrient values profiles for all countries. And so they know how much fat, energy, etc. is in the food supply. As part of this process, nutrition science has been utterly central. And again, I will explain further. And as part of this, my Australian colleague, Georgi Scrinis, has said there is a new consumer citizen type. This person has emerged over the last 20 or 30 years, and he calls that person the nutri-centric consumer. This is somebody who goes shopping looking at the fine print on all the labels. This is a person who considers health, the nutrient profile of their food and their diet, to matter more than anything, possibly price first, but nutrition second. Now, you could be wondering, why am I actually almost critiquing this person? And I am, in a partial way. Because in another reading of this, this is a person whom governments have aspired to create over 40 or 50 years. This is what dietitians and nutritionists are after. This is a person who cares about what they eat. But I am saying, when it is an individualized form of nutrition-centric being, then there may be problems. I'm going to just go very quickly over this slide, but a lovely special issue of a journal edited by Julie Guthman in 2014 with a range of papers on critical nutrition studies. So I've referenced these at the end. So, but really, it covers a big terrain, but very much considering the science policy advice interface and how to encourage us all to be better eaters. Now, this is some of the ways in which some of these critical nutrition scientists have been talking about the current capitalist, what they call the capitalist food system, and bodily power. Julie Guthman, in an earlier book, said, well, really, bodies are literally absorbing the conditions and externalities of the food system. She and Tony Winston there, 2013, they devote chapters to the state of food processing and the way nutrients are stripped out of foods in order to make them cheaper and more palatable. But then we add ingredients in order to make the foods healthier again. But some of that stripping away and some of the new additives, both of these authors argue, can be quite toxic. Jorgi Skrinis, in his full-length book, has said we really need to question how nutrition science is being used and by whom. Often it is taken out of context. And Tony Winston says, look, let's forget about the food system. Let's take a further step back, and we actually need to ask some serious questions about the economic system that subordinates nutritional quality and human health to the maximisation of investor returns. Let's really look at what is driving this. Tony Wilson, in a poetic way, said, Healthism, another view of my nutritionalization, have sidelined pleasure in food. A handful of corporations have a vested interest in not letting eating be simply a random act of average human imagination. Then Jorgi Skrinis years earlier said, for the nutricentric person, and I reckon for many of us in here, we judge our lives by, do we have high cholesterol or low? What's our blood pressure? What's our blood sugar? Our GI, glycemic index? Our BMI, our hip waist ratio? This is how lives are being lived in terms of these biomarkers. This is the nutricentric person taken to extreme. Very quickly, I have written a paper in Agriculture and Human Values that is referenced. This is not, as Heisman and Mellenton said in 2001, a new phenomenon, really. In my opinion, it goes back 150 years. It began in the chemists' laboratories of Leipzig, Germany, and it was all around chemists identifying particular molecules and other things that I don't understand. But in the mid-1800s, they were able to isolate something that they called protein. And they then went on to say, well, of all the important nutrients in the body, protein was the master nutrient. A few decades later, there was an acceptance, it had just been identified, that the calorie was a most effective way of capturing energy, bodily energy. And then at the turn of the 20th century, the vitamin was identified, and it was viewed as a protective food. These are all absolutely integral to where we are now. So, as a result of this, this is just the slide of annual US meat consumption from the turn of the 20th century. Those big meat-producing countries, Australia included, for them the identification of protein as the master nutrient and meat as the master protein for them, not pulses, legumes, anything else, but meat. This was a godsend. And on the basis of this, Canada, New Zealand, Australia, US began to export large volumes of meat, not just as food, but as good nutrition. Then, what did the finding of the calorie do? According to a social historian, the calorie popularized a set of assumptions that allowed Americans to see food as an instrument of power and to envisage a world food problem amenable to political and scientific interventions. And that picture down the bottom is of Atwater, who was able to explain what the calorie was. In that way, once you had the calorie, you could then enumerate a country's food supply. You could say, well, it's low in calories, it's high in calories. You were able to go into poor people's homes, as home economists did, and say, no, there's not enough calories. And hence, you were able to encourage foods on the basis of, there was never too many calories, but always too few. This wonderful cartoon, the calorie allowed governments and others to decide the least a man can live on. Really, this did become very important in early social policies. In Australia, for example, we had something called the Harvester Judgment, I think around 1907, and it was based on housing costs and food costs, and a part of the food costs were about, well, adequacy of calories. And then what do protective foods lead us to? Well, there have been books written about our vitamania, but the vitamin was able to encapsulate the idea of other foods that could protect against disease. Not only could they foods could promote energy use, but you could actually eat to protect against rickets or bone disease if you drank enough milk. Now, in my opinion, we've moved on to the second wave of protective foods, and these are highly processed in the main. These do not just come via the dairy. These are called functional foods, and they have been enhanced with nutrients on the basis of evidence that they are going to improve your health, they're going to promote your health. Generally, their lives begin in the factory or the laboratory. And certainly to good effect after World War II, governments around the world fortified foods because of the food shortages to date, and the British fortified margarine and flour with vitamins and calcium, US enriched white bread with things that they'd already removed 50 years earlier through making the bread white. And we've got these new waves. So that's the middle of the 20th century, and in that last dot point, I'll take you through the others, but I mentioned there Yakult to aid digestion is a functional food. Nestle's yogurts to boost the immune system, they are quite current forms of functional food. But why is there this impetus for these foods? And PHODS, that's the pharmacy meets food. Well, yes, we in the developed world are obsessed with living longer. Not always better, but longer. But we are, performance, bodily performance is increasingly important. Where I have great sympathy for functional foods is in the developing world's desire to curb diseases caused by micronutrient deficiencies. And golden rice is perhaps the best known functional food, and ecologists of golden rice would stand up now and say, well, Jane, do you know how many bad things, how many unintended consequences that had for environments, rice farms, etc. But it still did make a huge dent in rice-eating countries' nutrition profiles. There's the competitive advantage that I've been alluding to all along. And where do we come in? It's our desire for healthy convenience. This notion that we can consume more in the present, just have those few more beers in the pub, we can have few more chips, but we can nullify those risks of present and past eating through future acts of consumption. We can actually eat foods that will tell us that if we eat those, we can lower our cholesterol, we can lower our blood pressure, we can do all of these things that we have possibly increased through our eating. And then, look, the Barocca tablet has to be. I don't know if that's a functional food, but, you know, let's have a lot to drink and then down the Barocca. This is the promise of so many functional foods. And it makes sense. From the International Grocery Distributors newsletter recently, there was this statement, 59% of UK shoppers feel that their diet isn't as healthy as it could be, but it's healthy enough. So international grocers ask, can reformulation help? And they go on to answer that, and they say, yes, the great public health benefit of reformulation is that people's diets can improve without any need to change habits or behaviour. And I have added, or act to improve the food system. Some people have called functional foods as the medicalization of the food system. So is product reformulation the answer? It may be one part of it. And I'm now going to flip though and say it's perhaps not an answer that appeals to me. I'm more interested now in another form of functional food, and that's called the superfood. These have not necessarily, I mean very few of them, have come courtesy of the laboratory or the pharmacy or the laboratory. Their origins do go back 150 years in terms of the identification of some foods as having protective properties, especially this component of antioxidants. These are molecules that slow or prevent the oxidation of other chemicals, again found by chemists, and second point, superfoods are distinct from industrially manufactured functional foods because they are found in nature. I've tried to find out when the term came. Wikipedia tells me 2004, beginning the superfruits like goji berry. I would like to hazard a guess it comes with oily fish and fish oils, so much earlier. Cancer Research UK has said the term superfood, there's nothing to it really. It's really just a marketing tool with little scientific basis to it. And the term was banned in the EU of 2011 unless accompanied by evidence from authoritative science. So as I say, this is not new, but the manifestation keeps being transformed. This wonderful observation from a newspaper, again quoted by a social historian, captures for me what is happening. Taste and habit, long the sole arbiters of the dining table, seem overthrown, wrote one observer in 1930. Man, and perhaps more particularly woman of the 1930 genus, no longer eats what he likes in nonchalant, abandoned, fancy-free. He eats what he thinks is good for him on some scientific or pseudo-scientific There has been uncritical support for nutritionalisation, and I think I've touched on some of the major actors who are embracing this. What I'd like to turn to is, well, where is the critique coming from? And even within nutrition science, there is a reaction against forms of eating that are medicalised and that really just pivot on the nutrition, the nutrient. There have been economic critiques of the major actors who are making money out of this fear for our health, and there has been social movement pressure for the ecological re-embedding of diets and saying environments matter, community matters, conviviality matters, social table matters, etc. So just before I get onto my story of quinoa, I'm just going to, this is very quickly, this is an even broader view of the food crisis. So I've said there is the standard government narrative, there is the critical nutrition narrative, here is the more ecological narrative. And here the food crisis is not just about nutrients in the food supply. It is about the growth of the food supply and how it's and its impact on the environment, new diseases, urban encroachment, labour incomes and shortages in the food system. And it's about distributional issues. It's about food waste. And it is about consumer income, skills and knowledge. Including nutritional cacophony and confusion and ontological insecurity, but increasingly about how can households afford decent food. Jason Law, who's just a prolific writer on capitalism and its ecological consequences, has said something about the food system that really resonates with me. He says, capitalism prevents us from seeing through their harnessing of four chips, food, energy, labour power, and natural resources. That is the basis of the industrial food system, four chips. Capitalism prevents us from seeing it as a way of organising nature, of human and non-human, to produce a particular form of value relations, a value relations that does ignore environments, that does ignore sociality. He and others have said, well, actually, if you really look at the food crisis, it's delivered a food system. We have a food system that actually is delivering not health but human disease. We have a food system that is delivering animal diseases and environmental degradation and the famous term due to a robbery system. And this is because it's all been done on the cheap at many levels and in many spheres of action. And one reason that we all support cheap food is that the wages we are paid are inadequate to pay for more. And there's a vicious circle going here. Cheap food and cheap labour power, for a century, that has been a magic formula. So there are all sorts of ecological repercussions. My former director of my centre, the great Tony McMichael, charted the nutritional and environmental consequences of what I've just been talking about. The rising global temperatures as the fat intake of the diet, particularly saturated fat from animals, goes up and up and up. He saw those two as totally interlinked. So, can we shift our way of understanding what is happening into bite-sized chunks so that we can actually act on the problems as we see them? Political economy, I've really been talking from that perspective. That talks about the key role of food, food trade, commodification of food, cheap labour. That's what that has focused on for 150 years. But there's this lovely other thinking that's coming into being and saying, yeah, political economy, well and good, but what about the biological aspect to economic relationships, the biosphere, including our own bodily and human biosphere? So, the next bit is what role for citizens consumers? And I'd like to get on to the Plymouth. There are numerous superfoods that I could have chosen, but I am struck by something that I find even hard to pronounce, and I cannot go into a cafe or restaurant without seeing quinoa fish. Okay, is this new? No. Well, NASA in 1993 said, while no single food can supply all the essential life-sustaining nutrients, quinoa comes as close as any other in the plant or animal kingdom. And then if you go on to more contemporary sites, you say, see, it is one of the only known grains that provide all the essential amino acids needed by the human body. It is also suitable for celiacs. It is gluten-free. It's very suitable for vegetarians and vegans. It's high in protein. And interestingly, for quinoa eaters who no longer eat quinoa, all sorts of adverse health conditions set up. So amongst traditional eaters, this group of epidemiologists have seen a rise in type 2 diabetes as they no longer eat their traditional grain. All adds up to a very powerful narrative. And here we see a scientist on the European Space Agency. They can each take up apparently one dish of their choosing, and she took up quinoa and mackerel, and it was headed the perfect meal in space. So who's driving this market? Well, celebrities. Oprah is featured in her something or other diet. NASA, I would call a celebrity body. The United Nations in 2002 declared the International Year of Quinoa. Health authorities are promoting it for the reasons I've been talking about. Consumers like myself are seeking a health advantage through having a novel food experience, including authentic peasant foods from South America. And in the Australian situation, the government is investing R&D monies in this new high value added crop to replace wheat. It has some very good environmental qualities. It's drought tolerant, and it doesn't bring so much salt to the surface. I must move on. Look, the internet abounds with breathless testimonials to what could happen if they deliver superfoods, especially quinoa. And in Australia, it is breathless. There's a new group of superfood contenders. They come from an exotic and faraway land where the weather is warm, the beaches are pristine, and the forests are lush. This powerful group of fruits is so rich in vitamins that it surpasses the past superfood master, the blueberry, and sets new global standards for nutrition and taste. And we believe that quinoa could make Australia a global superfood superpower. But where has this quinoa been coming from? What is the ecological story behind this production? Well, the largest producers, Peru and Bolivia, and Ecuador is number three, I think. The production output has been staggering in short spaces of time. More than half of the Peruvian output goes to the US, mainly into health food shops and restaurants. Only 10% of Bolivia's crop stays. That is, the amount available to local consumers is dropping and dropping. In order to feed the global demand in Peru, they are finding new sites for production, now moving to the northern coasts, which is really an important move because they can replace more water-intensive crops. But in the north, there are new pests and pesticides. I cannot find any consensus about the degree to which local populations, their consumption has dropped off and what has happened to their nutrition, because in some instances, Peruvian producers have had such substantial livelihood increases that their overall diet has improved hugely. And in other instances, there's been so little of the crop available in the country, it's become too expensive to eat. But just this last point is that as the prices lift producer household incomes, so more and more producers rush in to produce quinoa. They pull out other crops. And then there are supply gluts and plunging prices. And the people who have been pushed then out of being quinoa farmers have actually been the poorer, more traditional farmers, unable to compete with the more modern farms and the more modern technologies. So as I say, there's lack of consensus. World Bank has said quinoa has reached NASA, but it's becoming inaccessible for him. Others have said, look, Biodiversity International, Westerners, quinoa has really helped Peru's poor, but there's trouble ahead. The trouble is mainly biospheric, biological. The reliance on a very narrow range of varieties, damage through huge monocultures, and so many of these farmers have reduced their llama herds, which produce the natural fertilizers, so now they're buying in organic fertilizers. So some have said, well, look, there are risks, but there are also opportunities here. And particularly work from Sergio Schneider, a Brazilian rural sociologist, has said, well, look, there are ways
not everyone has to work for a corporation. This global trade in quinoa could open up opportunities. And he uses the term nested markets. It's a market nested within an industrial, mainstream, conventional marketplace. It's like a niche marketplace, but it is special, that last dot point. It differs with the conventional on the basis of the rules that govern the trade and the use of common pool resources. It is much more based on social solidarity between producers, among producers, and between producers and consumers. So there are examples of nested markets responses appearing in journals. For example, fair trade and organic supply chains, which have involved consumer buying support, and something where even on a global scale, producers come together and they develop the supply chain. They're in control. There is no middle supermarket to run the supply chain. We absolutely need more research on, because bioeconomies by their very nature are highly specific to spatial conditions, community conditions, demographics, and it's early days, but where the quinoa fits within a bioeconomy as well as the social solidarity or nested market is it is highly suited to those traditional quinoa producing countries. Is it so suited to Australia as we rush headlong into it? My talk could have been about oily fish, green leaf vegetable like kale, or almonds, an almond milk and almond paste. So in conclusion, I'm aware that I'm taking away from the panel. I just really believe that if we construct a food system, any food system, around a single values and set of relationships, like the nutrient, we are missing something. And this wonderful issue on Just Food from the International Journal of Feminist Approaches to Bioethics, it really talks up the range of injustices, including to the environment, that we are wreaking through our food choices. And what the authors say is that we really have to deal with reductionist science, detachment from our food, privatization, the corporatization of our food. We've got to actually think and deal in terms of that middle point, as vulnerable human beings, as dependent human beings, as people who have relationships to one another. And Lucy Gilson, in the almost final set point, said, can we eat and live well together? So there are things that I believe state governments can do around relationality, but particularly to stop this nexus of cheap, 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 cheap. And we've really got to question the role of precarious labour across the world, because that's where the cheap, the lowest household incomes are coming from. We've got high-level task forces talking about the need to broker between the urban and the rural. We've got to stop that detachment between the urban consumer and the rural producer. Where are alternative food systems? What role do organics play? Well, the critical nutrition people are a little bit concerned that actually they just lead to a bifurcated system. So a few people go to the farmers markets, everyone else goes to the supermarket. Yogi Skrinna says, well, actually, all the organics movement does is accentuate the already widespread perception of fear of nutrient security. So what role can alternative food movements play? And my final slide is, where are we, the eater, in all of this? We nutri-centric eaters are without doubt doing the right thing personally for our bodies. We're probably doing the right thing by the national economy because hopefully we're going to be less sick. But I just do think the way we're reducing our choices to the superfood of the day raises the questions about the cherry picking of nutritional advice. So we might be good citizens, but I think we're being unfair eaters. I think we're being unfair to the environment. I think we're being unfair to fellow citizens who can't pursue that route and for whom health inequalities are growing. But can we become polyethic eaters? You know, can we choose foods and diets without obsessing about it that are fair to the producers, that are fresh and good for ourselves and the environment? And that we bring people together around food as opposed to alienating them. And then there are this move to flexitarianism, eating less meat, is that a good thing? It shouldn't be local eaters. But there are a whole set of questions around this for governments, social movements, and citizens. So thank you.
Now is very much we would like your responses, but I think that we would like to offer a bit of a response. I don't know about you, but I'm not going to say I'm speechless because that's a bit of an exaggeration, but I think, Jane, credit to you for so beautifully outlining the complexities around our food system and some of the many, many issues that I think we're faced with. And certainly as a dietitian and a health professional, it's difficult to know where to start. And I find, you know, it's very easy to be cynical when you consider some of the big players, and I'm not sure if Stefan might be able to say something like that. But I'll hand over to Tim first, I think. Tim, yeah? And he's going to just give a short response and then we'll go over to the floor.
Okay, is this working?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah. So, I'm not really an academic. I'm really more of an activist or practitioner. And I'm a member of the Food Research Collaboration on that basis. So I've been involved in the local food sector for about 25 years now. And there's one particular initiative that I was involved with, and this really, Jane's talk really kind of brought up some of the issues and dilemmas that we faced with that, and I just wanted to recount that very quickly. So about 20 years ago, I was involved in Dorset, setting up things like farmers markets and the rest, and these, I think, were primarily a response to concerns about safety within the food system, things like traceability, and we had issues like BSE, and this was prior to foot and mouth, but we had salmonella and eggs. And there was a real desire from consumers to know where their food came from because of concerns about food safety. And so I think farmers' markets kind of just hit a particular point. But after being involved in those initiatives for a while, it became clear that they were becoming a kind of middle-class niche. And my interest in getting involved in food was much more about how do we reach those people who can't afford good food. And the obvious place to reach those people is through places like hospitals or schools or care homes. And so we started working a lot with schools. And it's a long story, but we started a fruit scheme at a primary school, and then in Dorset, where I'm based, in, when was it, 1981, the government took away all the nutritional standards for school meals, which meant that schools didn't order hot meals anymore. So in Dorset, the local authority got rid of all the kitchens in primary schools. And we were then, in sort of 2005 or so, talking to heads in Dorset who were saying, we have children on free school meals, and they get these sandwiches that are made in London, and they're so disgusting that none of the children want to eat them. So we don't have a very high take-up of free school meals, and therefore that impacts on our funding, because it's related to take-up of free school meals. Is there anything we could do? And we said, well, we could start to produce simple soup lunches for both the free school meal kids and for other kids. And we managed to get lots of volunteers involved, used lots of local produce. It was a real success. Went from one school to two schools, and then other schools got interested. And then the government reintroduced nutritional standards. So this was on the basis of many years of campaigning by people like Caroline Walker, plus, and then Jamie Oliver sort of came in at the end of that. And then the Blair government decided, okay, we're going to reintroduce nutritional standards. So then in Dorset, they had to bring back hot meals, having got rid of them in 1981. So, but to me, what was interesting was that we had developed a kind of civil society initiative that was very popular with the children. It was engaging lots of volunteers from the community, and then these soup meals didn't meet the nutritional standards, and we were told we couldn't continue with that. So then the county council said, well, that's not a problem. We're going to set up a contract with a company in Nottingham that has a factory that makes frozen ready meals. These frozen ready meals meet the nutritional standards. We'll truck them down from Nottingham and we'll reheat them in microwaves. No problem. So we didn't think that was a very good idea. We called a meeting of eight head teachers and said, surely we can do something better than this. Why don't we set up our own social enterprise to make proper school meals that meet the nutritional standards? So we did that. We started with eight schools. We now have 35 schools that we are supplying. It's a big operation, trying to prioritise local food. But one of the issues I think there is that we were kind of having to sort of shoehorn ourselves into these what seemed to be rather random nutritional standards. So for example, every meal, there had to be a piece of bread with the meal, even if we were serving pasta. So you'd often have children who'd not eat the meal and they'd just eat the bread. That was just an example of, you know, trying to meet these things. And the other dilemma I think we faced was that having to suddenly shift from something that had developed very kind of, you know, from the community with lots of engagement, suddenly it had to become a very sort of professionalised service. And we've spent the last, I don't know, 7 or 8 years getting it to a point where it actually breaks even, which we've finally done. But in the process, we've lost all of that community engagement. It's no longer a kind of an embedded activity, you know, within civil society that's really trying to shift food culture in schools. And it's become just a almost like the photocopying kind of contract. We just, again, just supply meals. They're a lot better than the frozen ready meals, but still we've got this kind of issue. So now we're faced with this challenge of how do we bring back, now that we've got the service to be viable, how do we bring back all that we've kind of lost in trying to challenge this other thing? So it's an interesting dilemma that we face at the moment, and I think it just raises this issue of we're not driven by nutritional standards, we're not driven by any one thing, but it becomes a real challenge to make these interventions in the food system and deal with it at a sort of systemic level, because you're having to, yeah, as I say, you've got to make it not go bankrupt, otherwise you can't continue. But in doing that, you end up losing all your volunteers, or maybe having to reduce the amount of organic produce or local produce, because et cetera, et cetera. So that was one of the things that the talk kind of raised for me. I thought it was a great talk, and I really enjoyed sort of thinking about the implications. So thank you.
Great, thanks very much. Jane, really enjoyed that, thank you. I learned a lot actually, and very much felt partly responsible for, you know, trying to buy so-called good food with lots of nutrition for, you know, my three kids, etc. And you know, I think the main thing I learned today from this talk is that, you know, whenever it says good food, then, you know, the world is never as simple as that. You know, we need to kind of dig deeper and try to understand how good food, what is labeled as good food, is constructed, where it comes from, and why is it good, and who says it's good, and who earns, you know, a buck from selling good food. And so it's all, you know, we need to always look behind the label. And as you said, good food has become a very big business, and as a result, you know, good food is not necessarily always good food. And that kind of connects to what Tim was saying. I think what is missing in this kind of good food bonanza, as it were, is what you mentioned at the end of your talk, is the relationality, is the relation that people, consumers have with the food and where it comes from. So until a year ago, I was based on the East Coast in North Essex, and I was involved in something called a local community supported agricultural scheme. Is anybody aware of, in Devon or Cornwall, of CSAs, community supported agriculture? Yeah?
There's some in Darlington.
Yes. Yeah. So there are lots of different CSAs, community supported agricultural schemes. They can just kind of issue a food box that you buy, but if they work properly, I would say, you know, they have a very close relationship between the farmers and the consumers. The consumer becomes part of a farm, as it were, and in that way, people get very much connected to the land. And you know, when we were based in Colchester, we were part of that local CSA. You know, we took the kids to some working days, and they learned about where the potatoes come from, etc. And you would chat to fellow people working in the fields. So there's a social aspect developing. We were also part of a food buying cooperative. Has anybody heard of Sumo Whole Foods? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it's a national food distributor of good food. But the good thing about it is that it produces social outcomes, not just distributing good food, but actually through this cooperative approach, you would have people meeting to buy food together, saving quite a bit of money by doing so. So there's the social outcome, which is really important. So these are just two examples that I think provide a sort of relationality that I think is often missing. And of course, since moving to Cornwall, we lost that, and we need to build it up again. It takes time, effort, and energy. Time and energy that we often don't have because we're running around and working too much and taking kids to schools, and you know, daily life comes in the way of relationality, of not just eating good food but actually being involved in good food. So I think I would love to hear a bit more about what's going on locally in terms of bringing that social aspect of food growing and food consumption back in. Thank you.
Thanks. I'm not going to say much more because I've probably said enough, but the thing that struck me from a dietetic perspective is this idea of the nutricentric, how do you say it, consumer, and for nutrition professionals, they're the kind of the gold standard,
yes,
or whatever.
Yes.
So if everybody was a nutricentric consumer, would that mean
might
be out of a job? But I think from a public health nutrition perspective, which is where I come from, it's a lot broader than that. And I think understanding the kind of wider ecological perspectives around the food system are crucial for any nutritional health professional. And that point you made about the food system delivering human disease and animal disease is, you know, is depressing, really. And I think certainly some of the teaching that I do with students is, and what I've discussed with Stefan earlier, is that with the big powerful players, it's very easy to get cynical and to feel that you're up against forces that are too strong. But there again, the social aspect, coming back to that, can we eat and live well together? Well, it comes back to the human contact and the social aspect, and going really back to the basics of the social eating, which I think really is, for me, what food is all about. That may sound oversimplistic, but I think maybe oversimplistic is what we need to be considering. I'm hoping that, you know, the start of a network and some more collaboration and some more discussion around some of these issues is a way of us kind of joining forces, you know, between the ivory towers and the people, you know, at grassroots doing work all at different levels, can actually join forces and come up with some really exciting actions and solutions to make things better.
Jane, do you want to
suggest that they are all wonderful examples of a re-embedding and of collectivities of people working together as opposed to the individual at home saying, I'm not healthy enough, I'm not healthy enough, and then going from one superfood to another. This will help me, this will bring back my energy, this will help me lose weight. If people can almost collectivize their worry about their diet, as opposed to really what the superfood phenomenon does is to isolate individuals, to say, I'm not doing well enough, but this, you know, it's like the silver bullet, this can help. I did want to just say something about Stefan's comment about we're all working too hard, certainly. Hours spent in the labour market in order to make a living wage makes it much harder to not pursue healthy convenience, but to cook whole meals from scratch, etc. But some people have pointed out to me, maybe it's no fluke that the French, in their forthcoming election, one of the debates is whether to cut back from 35 to 32 hours a week, in part to save their culinary culture and the cooked lunch during the daytime, at least. Yes, we do have to. None of this is to eat well and relationally is not easy, and it does take time.
Right, we would like any comments, questions from the floor. Does anyone have any? Right, I run around with the mic?
My name is Lorna Haynes, and I put my hand up right away because I have to fly off to get a bus.
Okay.
So, yes, I love the, I think you summed it up perfectly in delivering, as you said, more problems than answers. In fact, living disease and environmental destruction is what the whole food system, and I include agriculture, which of course is the essential, the other part hardly mentioned today. I'm old enough to have been around some time, and everything is that you hear today, you've heard it usually somewhere before. And everybody lately, I find, is getting excited at Olivier de Schutter's latest document about a sustainable future and hoping to change the kind of agriculture and systems that we have, which would include many of the corporate controls that we're talking about here. And yet, I can remember back in 1987, there was the Brundtland Report, which first mentioned the concept of sustainability. And there was a big hope at that time that we'd finally see the back of this corporate industrialized food type system and go over to an ecological, more ethical way of producing. But that didn't happen. We got the Rio Summit in 92, but still many words and many millions and millions of words and papers later, here we are again still talking about it. I like to say this because there are a lot of young people here, and you're all young, basically, not a lot younger than I am. And I think it is important then to realize that we are in crisis. Because this is not just something, oh, it's a problem that's just come up. It's been building and building, and it's a crunch point, it really is. And I feel that unless we are prepared to do something to defend a healthy agriculture and food system, we're not going to get it. It's going to get worse. And I have been living most of my life abroad. I have been engaged in academic work as well as NGO work. And coming to England 3 years ago, I've been trying to see how you make change happen. And I'm a bit perplexed. I feel academics have a responsibility because of their position as researchers, knowledge generators, to take a particular role in advising. We've heard there is advice given, but do we hear about it? How many of the scientists are actually getting the word through? I don't know if there's a professional body that regularly issues opinion on certain policies. Because what's going to change here, what's really going to change things, is when you get these things turned into policy. Activism from the base, people concerned, wonderful inspiring talks like this that get you moved. But then what do you do about it? You write to an MP about something that's coming up for debate. You inform them, you pressure them. And I think that unless we actually participate like this, either as professional bodies, but certainly as individuals, I think that's part of the change. Wonderful actions locally, that's important. But in order to be able to talk about an ethical choice, you've got to have a choice. For many people, no income, and in countries I know, there is no choice. You eat that or you lump it, you know, or you don't eat. So it's a luxury here that there is still an ethical choice. But if you want to have that, you've got to fight for it.
Thank you very much indeed. Any other?
Yes.
Hi there. My friend and I are master students at Exeter doing food security. This has been quite a cool talk. I've just got a question focused on Australia or the UK, kind of generally Western nations, where we see this crisis occurring that with wages and various parts of the economy don't allow us to spend proper or substantial money on proper food and we go to processed quick foods. So the question is, do you think that it is possible in the near future to kind of go back to having food as more, as a bigger part of our social kind of life and where we dedicate our time? And if it is possible, where are we going to see the changes that will bring this on? Is it kind of government or councils or individual basis?
I will ask my panelists to also comment on that. I have done some work in Thailand, and
really what we're talking about there, in part to answer your question, is if we want to stop the supermarketisation, anotherisation, of Thai society, saying to local government, protect your fresh markets. Because in fact, countries like the UK used to have inner city fresh markets, provincial markets. Still mainland Europe has a lot of them. I think, in fact, there is still the infrastructure in cities in the main that we can protect. We don't need to actually invent a new. And these fresh markets do supply an alternative set of relationships into the market to the supermarket. So I would say, where possible, protect and grow your fresh market where everybody can feel at home. Family, farmers markets, I do read that the poorer people feel alienated from them, they feel like middle class. But the fresh market seems to be, it's not laid out beautifully, it's not staffed by middle class people, the rough and tumble. I'm going to stop there, but that would be my one principal thing is, an ally to that is people are working on food hubs. These would be central depots where smaller farmers can bring their food and then it can be distributed to these fresh markets. But where possible, I do think we need to bypass supermarket supply chains.
Any other questions?
Tim,
which one did you want to respond to?
So my work around local food, we soon came to the conclusion that it wasn't enough to just run isolated initiatives, that we have to, so we started to create networks across the Southwest, and one of the things that came out of that network was an institution called the Wessex Reinvestment Trust, and what that was saying was that all these problems that we face, they're interrelated, and there are kind of certain underlying forces at work, which, as an economist, sort of by training, it would be looking at things like land, labour and capital, and then increasingly now data and knowledge. And you can look at the trends, over time with those different areas, so concentration of ownership of land, the concentration of the creation of money in small numbers of banking institutions who then, can put debt on top of it, interest on top of it. This sort of distinction between people who have to sell their labour and people who own, the means of production. It's not necessarily a kind of a Marxist perspective, but more if you look at someone like Thomas Piketty, who's saying that, incomes are stagnating while returns to capital are increasing. So then the question is, what are the interventions that you have to put in place to address those? So we were working particularly in the food system, but what we said is we need new financial mechanisms. We need to be able to, for example, have a way of getting local people to invest in the food initiatives that we're involved in. So we developed community shares as a way of doing that. That's really taken off. We needed ways to have access, that the producers could have access to affordable land. So it took us into community land trusts, particularly in relation to farms. We then looked at issues around housing. If you spend all your money on housing, you can't afford good food. So now we have a big initiative around affordable housing using community land trusts. And then you've got this whole issue around, the artificial intelligence and robotics. How do we counter that? So there's whole areas around the open sourcing of knowledge. And we have to sort of find ways to say, okay, food might be our focus, or housing might be our focus, or renewable energy might be our focus. We then have to say, what are these kind of processes that are going on in the economy, and how can we find ways to counter them? And just to sort of do a food initiative on its own, without addressing these bigger sort of systemic, movements in the economy and not sort of isolating a food initiative. I mean, even to say, yes, we need sort of community engagement, not just individual responses, but those food initiatives are only going to survive if you also are working on the financial system, or you're working on ownership of land or other areas as well. So that's what I think is important.
Yeah,